Well, what year is it? It's 2007. And in 2000, can you all hear me, by the way? Yeah. In 2007, actually, a landmark, I would say, in phonetics is being passed. Since 100 years ago, almost for the day, well, for the January at least, in January 1907, a mediocre maths graduate, as he said himself, bottom of the second class, and then turned reluctant law student, so reluctant that he only agreed to do law because his father insisted on it, knocked on the door of University College, very group of buildings that we're in now, and asked for employment. His name was Daniel Jones. He just returned from Paris, where for the last few years he'd been spending his time learning French and having daily contact with the professor of phonetics at the Sorbonne, the great Paul Passy. I say great because I think this man is very underestimated. Most people have never heard of him, and he certainly deserves to be heard of. And he acted as Jones's mentor until Passy's death in 1941. Passy had found this young Englishman to be his most brilliant pupil in phonetics. And he encouraged him to try to find somewhere where he could teach the subject. Fat chance, thought Jones. Well, he didn't say fat chance because it was 1907. But that's what he thought. But nevertheless, he went to UC, and it just so happened he came right at the time when they needed somebody to teach phonetics. And to his amazement, he said later on, he was offered a part-time lectureship in phonetics. And despite later attempts, let's have a look at him at that time. This was in fact the later, but it does show him as a relatively young man. One of the things I don't like about Daniel Jones, or perhaps people see him, because they always see him as a very old person, and of course he was young like everybody else, and as you can see, when he was 40, he was relatively well preserved. So anyway, despite later attempts made by Oxford, because there is a university there too, you know, to lure him away, he decided to stay here in UCL, and he managed to set up a department of phonetics. And that's essentially the reason we're all here today, because Daniel Jones knocked at a suitable door. Now, if you take Daniel Jones, as most people know of him, I think he's known for these achievements. That is to say, his 1909 pronunciation of English, the 1917 English Pronouncing Dictionary, the 1918 outline of English phonetics, the 1917 cardinal vowel system, which he invented around that time, and from 1970 onwards, the promulgation of the phoneme concept. I don't want to diminish any of these achievements. In fact, I'm going to talk about all of them in due course. But I do think that he is also worth remembering for many other things. So I shall also be dealing with what I've termed in the past, some of you will know that I've termed it in the past, the secret life of Daniel Jones. That is to say, the many notable breakthroughs, the many discoveries and the observations made by this remarkable man. After writing Jones's biography, the real Professor Higgins, my colleague Inga Mason and I assembled Jones's early editions, his lesser-known works, and his articles and correspondence, unpublished lecture notes, into a set called Collected Works. These appeared in 2003. And I've drawn on some of this hitherto unknown or forgotten material for parts of this paper. A great deal of that material, by the way, is in the archive here in University College. And if you go there and get down on your bended knees and wear kid gloves and offer to be a very good person, then they may even let you look at them. It's all there in the college library. Anyway, let's begin this story in 1909, just 2 years after Jones arrived at UC. And he then produced this book, a little book, called The Pronunciation of English. And its importance is derived from the fact that it's the earliest of his many books. But not only for that. It was really the most successful textbook on phonetics which had been published up till then. It contains actually much which, if we read it with 21st century eyes, appears oversimplified or inaccurate. And Jones was eventually very ashamed of it himself. According to Olive Tooley, a lady who some people here will remember well, Daniel Jones, and you've got a close friend of Daniel Jones, Daniel Jones was wont to say of the first edition, every copy should be burnt. One can understand why he says that. There's much in it that's prescriptive, there's much in it which is inaccurate, there's much in it which he undoubtedly regretted later on. But nevertheless, the pronunciation of English provided a brief, elementary description of English, which was very much needed at the time. And to quote Robert Birchfield, he set down all that he concluded one needed to know about English speech sounds in 69 pages with the utmost clarity. It's longer than 69 pages, in fact, but most of the rest of the book is taken up with various samples of phonetic transcriptions. Because of its brevity and the simple pragmatic approach, the pronunciation of English was in every way more accessible to the non-specialist than what must be admitted are the technically superior works of Henry Sweet. It sold well. It made Jones's name known, if not worldwide, at least very widely. And his 1950 revised third edition of Jones's pronunciation of English provided a much tighter and linguistically competent description. Although by that time there was no chance of the pronunciation of English making any great impact, if only because the outline was then so well established as the standard description of modern British English pronunciation, RP, as Jones himself christened it in 1926. Here is a slide showing a heavily annotated version, a heavily annotated copy of the pronunciation of English, which I have in my possession. It was passed on to me by Olive Tooley, and I intend to give it to the archive in a couple of years' time. And you'll see there a very Jonesian admonition. Accuracy, accuracy, accuracy. As I say, this copy is very heavily annotated throughout and is quite revealing in terms of providing insights into Jones's views on the subject. That is in the, as I said, is in the collection which we've put together. The next book which he published is a book called Intonation Curves. And this is a rather remarkable treatment of intonation. In the history of the development of descriptive theories of intonation, Daniel Jones played a really leading role. And nowadays it's largely forgotten and ignored by historiographers. Notable exception to this is to be found in Alan Cruttendon's historical survey of intonation studies. Unfortunately, this is a thesis not readily available. But in this, he points out the significance of Jones's book, Intonation Curves. The early work of Jones, he says, was, however, chiefly important in making use of the newly invented gramophone. It represented an important advance in the study of intonation, paving the way for future experimental underpinning of auditory analysis. How did he do it? Jones was blessed with relative pitch recognition, a kind of perfect pitch, which implies he was able to recognize the pitch of any musical note. And he used a gramophone disc, repeating a recording over and over again, lifting the needle off constantly to check the pitch of each syllable by ear. And then, armed with music paper, he would painstakingly draw the pitch curve onto a music stave for each intonation group. The amount of work which must have gone into preparing intonation curves is quite incredible. And although the method may seem crude to us today, nevertheless, it was a means of getting some sort of relatively hard data about pitch features in connected speech, something which up to then just hadn't existed. And Jones went on to do more work on the intonation of English. So his 1909 study was the beginning. In 1919, he produced an interlinear marking system for the outline of English phonetics. And when we come to discuss that, I'll have a slide which shows you that. More importantly, I think, apart from his own publications, was his encouragement of colleagues in the British tradition. People who once again are forgotten today, H.O. Coleman. The man is so forgotten, I don't even know what his first names are. I'd have to pay a sum of money to St. Catherine's House in order to discover them. This man is the person who really invented what one might call the British School of Intonation Study. He is the person to whom we owe these concepts, such as nucleus, head, etc. He was followed by a person who is better known, Harold Palmer, who did much work in Japan. Harold Palmer is, as I'm sure John Wells would be able to tell us, that he is the man who we really go directly to for the first step in intonation. Again, this is somewhat forgotten these days. Later on, we had Lilias Armstrong and Ida Ward. Their work, A Handbook of English Intonation, that sold very well. It was very successful. It was still in print until a relatively short time ago. I don't know if it is still in print now, but it was still going around at the end of the 20th century. The way in which they presented their material, however, didn't take account of Palmer and Coleman's work. And in some ways it could be regarded as a step backwards. Nevertheless, these two pupils of Daniel Jones, they made people aware of intonation. They made people aware that this is a phenomenon which had to be studied. And then there were later followers, and we have many intonationists who go back to these people who Daniel Jones had as his pupils. Much of what you find in Armstrong and Ward is actually derived from the outline. This then is the contribution of Daniel Jones to intonation study. The next thing which we have to deal with on the slide here is founding this phonetics department. 5 years after his arrival at University College, after a long period of intensive teaching and publication, if you read the notices for the lectures in those days, they strike us as being very charming these days. We're told very often that the lecture will be illustrated by lantern slides. You can imagine the effect, though it must have been for the time a very good way of presenting your material, the best way of showing pictorial elements. Anyway, Jones was rewarded in 1912 by phonetics being granted official status as a department, with himself as at the head, and he had one assistant. And this was the first department of phonetics in the British University, and indeed it was to remain unique for well over a decade. In 1921, at long last, because he'd been waiting a long time for it, Jones obtained his UCL chair in phonetics, and in so doing, he became the first professor of phonetics in the British University. And it was later followed by the appointment of other people in London. So Arthur Lloyd James, a colleague of Daniel Jones, appointed to the School of Oriental Studies, later on renamed the School of Oriental and African Studies, SOAS. And this heralded a period of close cooperation between these two institutes. After the Second World War, phonetics departments were set up at Edinburgh and Leeds, headed by two former Jones students, David Abercrombie at Edinburgh and Peter McCarthy at Leeds.
Incidentally, there is one interesting point about Jones's department in the 20s and the 30s. More than half the staff were women. In fact, it was almost certainly the most female-populated department in UCL, and probably in London University, maybe in any university in Britain. And so Jones expressed his feelings for gender equality in very practical ways. Let's move back to his publications. Jones, in 1913, produced a dedicated pronunciation dictionary, the first, in fact, that had been produced for well over 100 years. This now forgotten work was entitled A Phonetic Dictionary of the English Language, and it was by Jones, in writing in cooperation with a man called Hermann Michaelis, a German headmaster. At the time, there was simply no reliable dictionary guide to the pronunciation of English words. Much had appeared in the 18th century, notably Walker's 1791 hugely successful critical pronouncing dictionary. But nothing of note since then. There was one publication by a Swede called Afzelius. Once again, people tend to forget this publication even exists. It made no impression. Not a bad work, actually, but it made very little impression. So by any standard, a reliable pronunciation dictionary was long overdue. Very shortly, the Oxford History of Lexicography is due to appear, and there's a chapter in there written by me together with Inga Mace and Joan Beale of Sheffield University, where we discuss the history of pronunciation dictionaries in fairly full detail. Let's have a look at a title page from this. We'll go back to talk about it again later. The Michaelis Jones dictionary was very reliable, but, and it's a big but, the dictionary was bizarre in as much as its entries are reversed. The phonetic transcription comes first and the orthographic form second. And this makes it absolute horror to look up words in this dictionary. It wasn't a commercial success. Not just because of the reverse arrangement. There was never going to be a great future for a book on English pronunciation published in Germany on the eve of the First World War. It reminds you a little bit of the attempts which were made some time ago to advertise southern Lebanon as a holiday resort. But the Michaelis Jones Dictionary did provide the groundwork for Jones's renowned English pronunciation dictionary, which was the only widely used English pronunciation dictionary for most of the 20th century. That's what we'll come to shortly. Here you have a history of the significant dictionaries in Britain. Phonetic Dictionary of the English Language, of course, wasn't published in Britain, it was published in Germany. But then in 1917, we're going to see the first edition of Jones's English Pronunciation Dictionary. In 1977, Gimson produced an important revision of the EPD, as it's always known. In 1919, we have John Wells's, I hope you won't blush if I say, masterly LPD. And in 1997, we have Roach and Hartman's, and there is a hidden person there, Jane Setter, who did very important work on that dictionary. She was here earlier today teaching on the summer course. And that's the revised 15th edition of the EPD. But let's move on now to the EPD itself. There is the title page, I think this one, in fact, is the 1919 version of it, which is exactly the same, in fact, as the 1917 version. So it looks like that, apart from the rather important matter of the date, but otherwise the content is precisely the same. And facing the title page, we have as a frontispiece the cardinal vowels. But let's first of all have a look at the dictionary itself.
The importance of the EPD, according to the late, great Peter Ladefoged, was that it was undoubtedly the major work, Ladefoged says, on the pronunciation of the prestige form of British English. It's difficult to overestimate its significance. As I said earlier, no significant English pronunciation dictionary had been published in Britain since the end of the 18th century. It was a landmark in lexicography and the history of the description of the language. It took the place of the Oxford dictionary, which had an appalling pronunciation component. Somebody once described it, perhaps a little unfairly, as sounding like the efforts of a demented Scotsman who is at least 150 years old, which is harsh, but not all that far from the truth. And if anybody has ever tried to use the old versions of the EPD with the transcription there, then they'll know what I mean. So with the publication of the EPD, then it became, in fact, the standard. People would look things up in the EPD regarding this in the same way as they would regard looking it up in the Oxford Dictionary. If they had any sense, they would certainly not look up pronunciation in the Oxford Dictionary. And it retained throughout the 20th century until 1990, its reputation appeared unassailable. When John Wells produced his Longman Pronunciation Dictionary, as I've said, it toppled from its pinnacle. But nevertheless, in the revised form edited by Roach, Hartman and Setter, the EPD now remains a famous and highly regarded publication. Now, many years, 90 years I think it is, after its first appearance. It's so therefore all the more remarkable that the EPD was originally, and in all its revisions up to 1963, entirely the work of one man, working on his own, without the aid of computers or any modern apparatus of dictionary compilation. Jones' dictionary was taken over by A.C. Gibson, who we'll come to later, in the 60s. He produced a very much altered version of the EPD with a different transcription system, the one, in fact, which is in general use today, in 1977. As is the case of the pronunciation of English, Jones ensured that his dictionary was easy to use and easy to understand. It had a fairly simple transcription system. Jones didn't like it very much. He'd taken it over from other people. But it did have the advantage of being simple and easy to understand. And Birchfield commented, both the pronunciation of English and the EPD were books that the general public or university student could turn to with the certainty that you'd find an uncomplicated answer to what one was looking for. Now, as I've already mentioned, there tucked away inside the EPD was another matter which Jones is famous for. That is to say, his cardinal vowel system. And this diagram was used as a frontispiece, and with the first edition in 1917. Jones had mentioned the cardinal vowels a little bit earlier in a book called The Sechuana Reader, which we'll be discussing in a minute or two, but it's only a very brief reference. Here the diagram shown in full, in recognisable form. Later in 1917, Jones made the first of several recordings of the cardinal vowels. Now, arrangements of vowels in similar geometrical form of triangles or quadrilaterals, we can trace back to the 18th century, to Hellbach, in fact. Jones was also indebted, indirectly, to Alexander Melville's book, his amazing book, Visible Speech. And in there, as in much else, there are systems of vowel description. More directly, he's indebted to Paul Passy. Paul Passy produced something which is very, very similar to the cardinal vowels. And people sometimes think there's a striking resemblance between the cardinal vowels and the vowels of French.
And I think this resemblance is more than accidental. Paul Passy was a speaker of Parisian French. He was an aristocrat and spoke the standard form of French. And a conservative accent of French does have something very similar to the cardinal vowels in it. However, the final step in the construction of this system of vowel description was Jones's own. And he provided something which fulfilled the requirements for a simple, well, relatively scientific model. The cardinal vowel system was capable of taking in relatively complex data and by means of simplification and schematization, reducing these to a few significant parameters, which could be subjected to further analysis. Within an articulatory model of phonetics, the cardinal vowel system provided an excellent way of noting the essential factors needed for discrimination and reproduction of vowel qualities. Apart from being a first-class shorthand system for the linguistic field worker, it also allowed a useful teaching method. And as long as one wasn't in search of perfect performance imitation by students, the basic system was relatively easy to learn. Where Jones later failed was in not being readily satisfied with the virtues of this system and accept its limitations. He began instead to believe that it would add to the status of phonetics as a science and attempted to confirm his theories with hard evidence in the form of X-ray data to show that there was indeed a firm scientific basis for the largely hypothetical model of equal intervals between the tongue postures of the various primary cardinal vowels. Later research was to confound rather than corroborate Jones's suppositions. The other thing was, I think, that Jones began to regard the cardinal vowels as being almost religious in nature. And for a period of about 40 years at least, within the British school, the cardinal vowel system, despite its obvious deficiencies, were regarded with reverence, and Jones's pronouncements accepted virtually without question. He sees sometimes almost to judge people's all-round ability as phoneticians on their practical phonetic performance. David Abercrombie, later to be head of phonetics at Edinburgh, who I interviewed some time ago, but I think he's also stated this public, claims that when Jones was asked about him, he replied, "Abercrombie, nice chap, but he can't make a good cardinal three." Nevertheless, strong doubts were expressed by other scholars, notably Russell in 1928, who claimed that phoneticians are thinking in terms of acoustic fact and they're using physiological fantasy to express the idea. It's not likely, notwithstanding the valid doubts of these scholars, that the cardinal vowels will in some form survive, if only because of the huge corpus of work already extant which makes use of it. Whether for the future it'll have to be modified to fit present day knowledge remains to be seen. I think personally it probably will have to be. Nevertheless, Jones would probably be very well satisfied if he knew that the latest 2005 version of the International Phonetic Alphabet chart still shows his vowel model in a later, somewhat more developed form, virtually completely intact. Now, these have been up till now, I think, with the exception maybe of the of Mihaly's dictionary and intonation curves. I think this has been mostly things which are well known about Jones. But now we come up to something which people seem not to have a great knowledge of, and that is the contribution which Jones has made to the study of African tone language. It's remarkable how little mention is made in present-day phonetic literature of Jones's part in the development of research on tone, given how far ahead of the time he was. His Sechuana reader, which is his 1916 survey of Chuana, a southern African language, written with a brilliant informant come author, Sol Plaki, is a milestone in tone analysis, an achievement not only for Jones himself, but for linguistics
as a whole. Here is the title page, and as you can see, it's in an alphabet in Chuana. He called it Sechuana because Sechuana just means language of the Chuana. And it provides the first accurate description and, with its limitations, reliable analysis of an African term language, incorporating the crucial concept of downstep, even though Jones doesn't employ that term. Jones's further research on Chuana took the analysis of the relationship of tone and grammatical meaning further than anyone had to that date. He came up with a significant contribution to notation. He was one who invented the raised exclamation mark to show downstep, which has now been abandoned, but which was used almost all the way from the 19th century. And he subsequently returned to analyze Chuana and other tone languages in his phoneme, which came out in 1950. He also invented the term toning. And Jones encouraged his staff and pupils to undertake research on tone languages. And so for many years, Britain, essentially UCL and SOAS, led the world. His most, let me go back one slide, his most distinguished protege was Ida Ward. But close behind came Lilias Armstrong, Douglas Beach, Clement Doak, Archibald Tucker, Eugenie Henderson, and Jack Carmichael. And some people here will remember these people and remember them for the great linguists that they were. In 1917, we have another of Jones's well-known seem to have lost it. Go back. We have one of his other well-known contributions, and that is his promulgation of the phoneme concept. Jones never made any claims to having played any role in actually devising the phoneme concept, as he states explicitly in his brief monograph, History and Meaning of the Term Phoneme. He just absorbed the work of the Kazania school of linguists, Baudouin de Courtenay and Krzyzewski, largely through contacts with their pupils, Szczeba and Benny. In addition, Jones had been profoundly influenced by Sweet's notions with regard to broad and narrow forms of transcription, and also the similar ideas of Passy. As early as 1915, the phoneme concept, according to Jones, was in everyday use in the department. The Sechuana reader, which we've just discussed, showed Jones working implicitly within the phoneme principle, even though he didn't use the actual word. And he later included several explicit references to the phoneme in a lecture to the Philological Society on the Chuana language in 1917. An examination of his actual lecture notes, which I have made, reveals that his later claim to have provided an explanation of the term phoneme in this talk is correct. And the report of the lecture that appears in the transcriptions of the Philological Society, even though J.L. Jones claims it was incomplete, clearly shows that he, Jones, has to be recognized as the first Western European linguist actually to employ the word phoneme in the present-day sense in a publication. Many years before Bloomfield, 1925, and long before the American structuralists began their long preoccupation with the prophoneme concept in the 30s. In the colloquial Sinhalese Reader in 1919, Jones defined the phoneme in terms very similar to those he'd adhered to for the rest of his career, namely a group of related sounds of a given language which are so used in connected speech that no one of them ever occurs in positions which any other can occupy. So he'd thus arrived at the dual criteria of phonetic similarity and complementary distribution. The latter term being a structuralist usage, which Jones accepted for the first time in the History and Meaning of the Term Phoneme, which he produced in 1957. At the same time, he refused to accept the validity of free variation within the phoneme definition. And meaning as such was excluded from his definition.
though it's always, actually meaning is always there, or clearly, at the back of his mind. Jones goes on immediately in the Sinhalese reader to specify the semantic function of the phoneme in distinguishing word meanings, as opposed to speech sounds belonging to the same phoneme, that's allophones, which cannot distinguish one word from another. Jones was later to expand his view of the phoneme in several directions in order to cover a number of suprasegmental features. And the first of these, as I mentioned briefly, was the now widely used term toneme, which, according to Jones, was coined at his suggestion and taken up by Beach and other members of the UCL department. And this was in 1921, long, long before similar publications in America. Later on, he had a few other emes. So he had the croneme for length and the stroneme for stress as units of length and stress, respectively. Well, those didn't catch on, and probably for some people they're very unfamiliar. Another practical first of Daniel Jones was the first phonetics laboratory. In 1913, he set up this first phonetics laboratory in UCL. About this time, incidentally, Bernard Shaw visited Jones, and a description of DJ's lab equipment is actually to be found in the stage directions for the play Pygmalion. Incidentally, it's likely that Daniel Jones, and not Henry Sweet, was the inspiration for Shaw's hero in that play, Henry Higgins. And this is something which I incorporated at the suggestion of Jack Windsor Lewis, sitting here in the front row, into the title of my biography. Jack suggested the real Professor Higgins, and I took that idea on. Jones apparently claimed, incidentally, that Shaw got the idea for the name from the once famous South London department store, Jones and Higgins. He needed a name for the character, and he is supposed to have said, since I couldn't call him Jones, I'll call him Higgins. Jones winkled money out of the university and supplemented this with gifts of used equipment. He was grudgingly allowed a room for the lab, and a part-time assistant, Stephen Jones, no relation to Rennett. And Steve Jones, incidentally, was the man who published a review in the Maître Phonétique of a book on Spanish, written in English, which he chose to write not only in phonetic transcription, but also in his native language, Welsh. And this is sometimes claimed to be the least read article in the world. But I think there are too many rivals to that particular competition for us ever to be able to declare a winner. And I will tell the story again, some of you have heard it. But many years ago, on a year of the visit to UCL, I happened to mention the matter to John Wells, sitting up there at the back. And perhaps typically, he leapt over to the cupboard, drew out the relevant copy of the MF, and putting me as, I am a non-Welsh-speaking Welshman, putting me as a non-Welsh-speaking Welshman to shame, started reading it through. And he then said, have you noticed the error in line 10? So this then was the man, Stephen Jones, who started, no relation to Jones, by the way, not a brother or anything. Stephen Jones was a Welsh-speaking Welshman. Daniel Jones was certainly not a Welsh-speaking Welshman. He made very clear in his publications that he was a Londoner, he was proud of being a Londoner, and that his Welsh ancestors were at least about 400 years ago. We have, incidentally, in a scheme which Daniel Jones drew up for a phonetic institute, we have an interesting plan for a language laboratory. We'll come to that in a minute or two. By 1919, Jones had become enmeshed in this grandiose scheme for a phonetics institute. and it took up much of his energy for several years. When it finally collapsed, left him literally with a nervous breakdown. And the architect's drawings for the Institute have survived, and they illustrate how lavish the facilities would have been. The Institute would have spread out over a prime site nearly the size of a football field in Bloomsbury. Jones was later to reveal in correspondence to the UC provost at the time, by far the best possible site would be the block of houses forming the north side of Gordon Square, together with the six adjoining houses in Gordon Street and the first five houses in Tavistock Street. Ironically, this is very close to where UCL Phonetics Department eventually ended up, but not in the palatial edifice plan, but in a couple of converted family houses. And as you know, it's still there to this day, perhaps with DJ's spirit haunting its dusty staircases and linoleum-covered corridors. And the linoleum I nearly killed myself on yesterday in the rain, so it's, I was rather lucky to survive coming here. However, exactly 100